Greece on the precipice, and now questions about the involvement of U.S. banks and Goldman Sachs in propping Greece up, then betting the country will default on its debt. Fortune's managing editor Andy Sir, we're here with some strong opinions on this one. Andy, you have a good analogy here.
Well, there's a couple sort of basic, you know, fundamental points about human behavior, I think, that come into play here. And let's start with the first one about these credit default swaps in Greece. And, you know, this is sort of betting that the country's debt will deteriorate.
After having helped give Greece credit.
That's right. Okay, so let me ask you a question, Poppy. If you bet $5 million that I would die, and then $10 million, and other people saw it, $50 million, $100 million that I would die soon, do you think that would increase the likelihood of maybe someone taking out a contract on me? Or if I got in a car accident, maybe not calling the ambulance right away? I think so. I mean, that's a very perverse, twisted way of looking at things, but I think it's a kind of an apt analogy.
Let's be clear here on two points. One, Goldman had no comment on this. Mm-hmm. And two, there is a stark difference between the letter of the law and the spirit of the law. And these swaps were legal.
That's right. And besides Goldman, another point we should make, there are other U.S. banks involved as well, J.P. Morgan. Goldman, of course, is the name that everyone just likes to bring up here. Of course, they were involved. But your point about letter and spirit of the law, I think, is another fundamental precept here we should talk about. And that is that, you know, according to what I've read, it doesn't appear that the U.S. banks violated the letter of the law. In other words, the European Union had strict regulations about what would count as debt on these countries' balance sheets, and so these banks crafted securities that would circumvent
that.
Right, exactly. But the question is, does it violate the spirit of the law? Yes. Yes, it does violate the spirit of the law, because what the law was trying to do was safeguard the economies of these countries. Mm-hmm. And what these banks did not do that. In fact, it did the opposite.
And Fed Chairman Ben Bernanke sort of said it mildly, called it counterproductive, said the Fed and the SEC are investigating. But what can they do? If it is legal, how does this show us, Andy, that nothing has changed?
Well, every time, that's the problem with regulation generally, is that every time you set a law, remember, these people on Wall Street are some of the smartest people on the planet. They'll look to get around the law somehow, staying within the letter of the law, but to my mind, violating the spirit of the law. And, you know, the British legal system has, you know, concepts whereby you have to not violate the spirit of the law. And I think we need to maybe adopt some of that. And another point about this spirit of the law, letter of the law thing, I mean, I'd like to ask some of these bankers, could they explain this to their seven-year-old? Well, daddy did this and it's legal, but, you know, doesn't sound right. It doesn't sound good, and I think that's a real problem.
But this also isn't the first time. I mean, look back just 6 months, a year ago, when there was so much reporting on what Goldman Sachs and other U.S. banks had done in terms of the housing market, putting their clients in one position for U.S. housing, and on the other side, on the prop desk, making their own bets that the U.S. housing market would deteriorate. It is the same move, but it's against the country.
Right, exactly. And I think, you know, we are starting to see real Goldman fatigue. Goldman Sachs fatigue, and people are, you know, I've talked to chief executives just this past week who say, you know, listen, I was there willing to defend Goldman Sachs. They obviously, you know, provide a very useful function in our capital markets.
Sure.
But, you know, they've sort of had it up to here with this stuff, you know, that every day, every week, every month, there's a sort of a new chapter. Now, obviously, this stuff with Greece took place at the beginning of the last decade, or the beginning of this decade, I should say, around 2000, mm-hmm. but still, you know, before the firestorm of criticism, but still, you know, it's just this pattern of behavior mm-hmm. that, you know, these institutions are out for themselves at the expense of customers.
And let's remember, too, here, that it's not just big banks that are doing this. What's fascinating about the situation with Greece and the swaps is that you have all of these smaller funds that have profited hugely on this. They have invested in this as well. It's a lot of smaller institutions around the world also.
Well, that's right. I mean, that's when we start talking about systematic risk that, you know, all these institutions from all around the globe are involved, as you say. And, you know, there was one school of thought that, oh, we're making the world safer by distributing risk. Mm-hmm. Actually, you're making the world more dangerous by spreading the risk around. I mean, that was another falsehood that we learned about during the recent financial meltdown. And you know, we're still coming out of the financial meltdown. This is yet another shoe that has dropped. And you know, it's a closet of shoes. I mean, we don't know, you know, to extend the metaphor, unfortunately, perhaps, but we don't know where this is going to end. It's just difficult. It's vexing. And it's very problematic for regulators and politicians to try to solve this.
It certainly is. Keep it honest, Andy.
Thanks.
You.